said curiosity is the left part of our mind, which helps us to discover new parts in the world. In order to discover these new parts in the world, what we normally do is to ask questions, or maybe we use Google. When we find the answer in Google or with our friends, which we use is the right part of our mind, that is the critical thinking. Philosopher from Greece said critical thinking is the part of our mind which analyzes all the answers according to our knowledge. Today, my curiosity has a question. I think your critical thinking can answer this question. The question is, okay, I will spell a little bit. I consider all of you are fanatic of the public speaking, right? Because I'm here in a public speaking class. And I consider you like to tell brilliant ideas with wise words, right? But what do you prefer? To use wise words to explain a normal idea? Or do you prefer to have a really, really, really brilliant idea, very clear, and to use normal, a simple word? What do you think? What do you think? Who wants to be the first person to answer? Who wants to be the first person to answer? Can you stand up, please?
So I pick a wise answer in simple words so that everybody can understand this. Take on the message.
Wise words.
Very
good, very good. Thanks for your answer. Thank you. Let's see another opinion. Want to be? Should I pick up? Journalist? Are you willing to do it, eh?
Always. There are no wise words, only wise subjects. So if you have wise words, it's because your idea is already wise. And if you're able to express your idea, which is wise, the words will be wise as well.
Very sophisticated answer. Let's see. Second line. My friend, Eva, you just stand up.
Biting in the
crack. I think that is better use simple words to reach your audience.
Yeah. Very good. Who is the next?
No.
I would like to know the opinion of a journalist. Stuart was a journalist. I would like to know your opinion, brilliant, always.
Oh, you caught me out there. Wisdom. Simple words, and I think I've spoken about this before, Hemingway always used simple words because that's the easiest way to convey a clear message. Wisdom wraps us up in intelligence and intellectualism, but never delivers a message that we can understand and use. So clarity, brevity, much better than wise words of the philosophers.
Wise words. I really like your answer. I would like to know your English words, man. Well, let's go finish the warm up. Okay, now, last, please, can you tell me your answer?
Sir, actually,
I know. Yeah. Many times I don't understand my English. My question is, what do you prefer? Brilliant ideas and explain the brilliant idea with a simple words? Or do you prefer to use brilliant words, as Stuart, and to explain a really simple idea?
I think I prefer the first one.
Good choice.
Few minutes to think about the reason why.
Okay, very good, very good. Thank you very much. Thank you, everyone. Thank you to you, everyone, to use your critical thinking to answer my curiosity. Now, I want to explain a little bit the different roles of the night. First, the first role of the night is the Toastmaster. The Toastmaster is the person on charge to coordinate the meeting, to introduce the different speakers, to move slowly from one point another. So I take care of all of you because I have to take care of the room tonight. Then, today, we will have four speakers. initially, because normally we have free speaker, right? But today, we organize the agenda according to the people who solicited that. For each speaker, For each speaker, we'll have one evaluator. The evaluator will give us feedback about the speech of the people. Who will perform today as evaluator? Usually evaluator, who's playing a little bit the role evaluator?
Yeah,
because
each speech, the speaker, they want to do different project on this system menu. So each project, they have different objectives. So this, I think each of them want to achieve different things for the speech. So we just evaluate whether they achieve their objective and how they progress and what things they can improve next.
Okay, very good. Wise words. After evaluation, we have a break, maybe 10 minutes or 15 minutes, in order to charge our energy in our body for the second part of the meeting, maybe the table topics. Who will perform us today, the table topics? Can you explain a little bit?
Yes. Okay, for this night, table topics is very simple. We call any volunteer who wants to participate on table topics, and we ask a quick question. No more than 2 minutes, and you have to come across with the first thing that comes to your mind. That's the funny part of it. So anybody who in the break wants to participate, feel free to come to me and I will.
We have to control the timing. It's very important, the timing. Yes. That is why Paul is there. Paul, can you explain?
Yes, so the timers. We have a set of timing lights here. We have a traffic light system, so green, yellow, and red. Green means you're getting near your time. Yellow means you're getting very, very close to your time. And red means it's time for you to stop.
Also, we have a special role. He's the person in charge to organize the agenda. My friend, Kik, thank you very much to organize the agenda today. A little crazy, but you know, thank you. And that is two extra roles. One of the most important roles is you, the public, the members. I want you to collaborate and participate in this meeting as much as you can, because you have enough curiosity and critical thinking to do it. Other days we have grammarian, but today we'll skip this part because we are very intelligent about the grammar voice, so we can skip it for today. And we have as well another new role. I want you to think about it. What could be this extra role? I would like you use, again, your curiosity and your critical thinking. What could be the role? Do you have an idea?
Judgment for the Toastmaster.
This is a part I forgot. But very good. You know the program very well. The evaluator of the table topics is my friend, Pablo. Can you explain? Yeah? Okay, that's good. As you can see, we have a real Spanish night today. Because the table topic master, Spanish, and evaluator Spanish, I am Spanish. So, do you have any idea what could be the extra role?
Where is Conta?
What?
Where is Conta?
Conta, another part.
Two extra roles.
Can you explain the role of the Conta?
After each part, I will collect all your votes. Then we'll count today's best speaker, the best table topics, and then the best evaluator.
Thank you very much. No, this is no extra role. It's a role you won't find in the manual. It's an extra role I create for today. Any idea? No?
Fun master.
Okay. Close. Very close, very close.
Lots of
next
fun.
Week.
Thank you. The extra role of tonight is... I wonder what is the extra role. I want you to continue with your curiosity at the end. I will tell you the extra role at the end. Okay, the first speaker tonight is Jennifer. No. The first speaker tonight is David McKerr. To introduce David McKerr, who will give us his eyebreaker, I'm going to call to Jennifer, the evaluator. Jennifer?
I don't think she's here.
She's not here, is she?
She's not here. So, sorry.
I'll do it. Yes.
I have another volunteer here.
Oh, you have?
Case
he's evaluating one already.
Okay.
Yeah.
Please.
Okay, all right, so this is David's CC1. So in the CC1, we're focusing on the skills that David has already. So it will be his first speech to the club. So he's looking to tell us a little bit about himself. And also it's traditional in these moments to give our first speakers a very warm welcome and a great big round of applause. So if you could give a nice warm welcome, please, to the person doing his icebreaker on the author of your life, Mr. David McKerr.
Thank you for that lovely welcome, guys. This is a bit of a challenge for me standing here, and it's not the usual challenge that people do in the icebreaker face, where they come up and they think, how am I going to speak to people for 5 minutes? My challenge is, how am I going to speak to you for only 5 minutes? You see, last Sunday, for my business, I ran my first ever full-day seminar. So I stood up on stage and spoke for 6 hours. So how I can condense something meaningful into 5 minutes? Well, I'll let you guys be the judge of that. But the running theme throughout the seminar that I did was, you are the author of your life. You guys write the script for what you do, how you think, how you feel. You decide the levels of your happiness, success, and love in life. And I discovered this the hard way. So let me take you back to when I was 19 years old and I was suffering from depression. I was waking up in the mornings and wondering where I was going to summon the energy to get out of bed and face another drudgery of a day. And there were some mornings where I woke up and wished I hadn't woken up at all. And I reached the moment that I call the moment of critical mass. And this is where you are more fed up, you are more scared of staying the same than you are of changing. And my moment of critical mass came on New Year's Day, 2013. And I decided I was going to make a difference. I was going to change the script that I'd been living my life to. So I decided to connect with a lifelong dream I'd had, a dream of becoming an author. Since my earliest years, I'd always wanted to be an author. I was always my head in a book. I was always writing stories, role-playing these fantasy worlds that I had in my head. But I put this dream off for decades. And ultimately, I could only find my happiness by returning to it. And so I started to write. I had this idea in my head. I'd built this crime family, this Dutch crime family called the Schneiders. And I had all the characters in my head, all the idiosyncrasies of their relationships. And I started to write out their escapades, all the things that went on, their vendettas, their wars, their conflicts that they had. And I put all this down into a book. And on May 2013, I published the first book, The Saga of the Snipers. August 2014, I published my second. And suddenly I was feeling alive again. I had vibrancy, I had purpose, I had direction again in life. And where I am now is a result of reconnecting with my inner passion, what I was meant to do. Because I'm a storyteller. I tell stories. And in my business now, it's got a slightly different variation, but I still tell stories. I tell people a story about how they can change their lives and how they can find positivity, well-being. They can find their purpose and direction the exact way that I found mine. So I want to leave you with today, so each of you have the ability to write the script of your lives. You can't go back in the past and erase your mistakes, because unfortunately you're writing in pen. But ahead of you are blank pages, and you can choose whatever you want to write on those blank pages. So I hope I've managed to condense a 6-hour seminar into 5 minutes. If you want to find out the science and strategies of how you become the author of your life, then come and watch me for 6 hours. But that, guys, is the punchline. You're in control. Anything that you want in your life, you can create. Because there's nothing but blank pages waiting for you. Toastmasters, thank you very much.
Well done, well done. I'm really surprised because before I start the meeting, I asked David, I knew that David wrote a book, and I asked, why did you write a book? How is it possible to write a book? And David told me, I can tell you, what is the reason? And I thought, oh, David, tell me the reason. And now he told me the real reason. Very surprised, very surprised. Now, the second speaker of the night, that's in time, we're right. I will skip you. What does he do? No, would you give the speech, right?
Yeah.
Okay, perfect. And I would like to call the evaluator of the second speech of the night. Can you go to the stage, please?
Okay, so for yeah, we need to fill in the slip.
I think I will ask the feed at the end.
Okay.
Before the break.
Okay.
Do you allow me?
For course, this is his CC4 speech, which means he already built up some skills for CC1, 2, 3, which is icebreaking and organize his speech and get to the point. This one, the challenge is how to say it, how to use the correct word, how to use the wise words, and how to use it short and organize it really efficiently and correctly. So let's welcome Carl.
Hello everybody. The name of my speech is A Scary Story, and actually CC5. Yeah, I would like your help because this is a very special week, and I would like to your support because, you know, we are under budget and we need some special effects, and I would like to ask this group, when I said, when you are scared, you do like a woo, something like that. Is that right? Okay. When I do like the same here, I said woo as well. 1, 2, 3. Ooh. Yes. Excellent. Perfect. A special effect I read. My grandfather was a farmer, entrepreneur. He was born 130 years ago. I can say he died when he was 90, because I'm not able to say that. I was invited to a gathering in the north of the country, to America, was the usual thing, going to have a good time, eating very nice, loud music. Like, it's a party anywhere of the world, and I was very happy to go in there. I had to drive 1,000 kilometers, that was fine. So, mother knew I was going and told me, you are going to that area, is the family house. This is the key, in case you need it. The key of a 250 years old house. And in a city called Chepeng, where my grandfather was very proud to sell honey and all the things local. He was very happy to sell just for the locals, not big production, but still was nice. Then, at the last minute, my mother told me, very quiet voice, things happen. But don't worry, it's okay. The worst came in one ear and out the other, so I just forgot. And then I went to with my friend, arrived to the town, and they said, oh, by the way, came the whole family, we are a bit stretched, but we can accommodate. Okay, thanks, but I prefer to go to my family house to sleep there alone. So I went to the house. Before midnight, I decided to go to bed. I was admiring the house and the walls out of what do you call this? Adobe bricks, the walls were this size. You know, the old houses, wow. I was admiring this. I was feeling the floor made out of wooden, very cracky. Like this. And then I start to see the room. The room was just divided, but a little piece of a small wall of cardboard or something just very thin, and a very fragile door. And that was okay, it was our house. Anyway, it was empty many years. Suddenly, what happened? I was lying in bed. And came out a noise. Came a noise. A typewriter. Was not a typewriter. Was nobody there. Coach, what can we do? But wait, I was started, my heart was beating. And then I decided to ignore it. And it stopped. I tried to smile, but was not okay. After a few minutes, nobody was in the house, was empty. What was that noise? My heart was beating at 150. I didn't know. I started to feel scared. And then, ask for something to protect me. A cross, something religious, couldn't find anything, only I found a little praying book. And I hold to my chest, and my nails grab the cover and penetrate that. I was scared. I was locked there. Mother said, things happen in the ground floor. But I was in the first floor. I was trapped. Something was there. Then, stop again. What did I do? My heart was even 200, probably more. And then the final blow. what the worst thing could happen. Chains. The floor. My heart starts to beat, no, 200, it's 1,000. 1,000, I'm sure. I ran the marathon, but that was far faster. And then my breath was start to overventilating, and suddenly I black out. The next thing I remember was the sun coming through the window, the people walking in the street, and I touched myself to see if I was still alive. I can't be, I didn't want to be news. So that was the last, sorry, never, ever, ever came back to my father, my grandfather's house. This is for you know, Halloween.
Really good performance, that's it. Really good performance. You try to scare us. However, it's not possible because you always do this smile. I know your real face expression, so it should be really good for you. Try to scare the people because you are really funny person. Now, in order to overcome our fears, we have an amazing speaker who will teach us how to overcome our fears. Today, Stuart will perform the CC5, a leap of fear and faith. In order to evaluate Stuart, we have a key. Can you introduce Stuart, please?
Thank you. Today, Stuart will be doing the fifth speech from the CC manual. It's about all the body speaks. It's about trying to demonstrate and practice the use of eye contact, the use of a stage, which, as we can see, will be a bit of a challenge today. The use of the environment around him, getting his attention, hand gestures, body movement, balancing, all the small movements that make a difference between a speech and the speech actually makes a difference to people. Now, as a species, we are very sensitive to what we see. It's one of our strongest senses, and that is why it's one of the most important speeches in the manual to try and master the skills. The other part about it is also to make your body movements smooth, natural, and not seem contrived, which is one of the most difficult things to try and practice. In addition to the objectives from the manual, Stuart has told me he also wants to try and practice and see how he goes as humour. So I'm looking to see for all of you how you react to Stuart's speech and how well he gets himself across to make that bridge between the speaker and the audience. So a speech titled A Leap of Fear and Faith, Stuart Downton.
I'm going to take you on a journey tonight. Journey to the edge, to the very edge of fear. It's a place we visit, but we don't want to. It's a place that excites us and terrifies us at the same time. It's a place of power where we can choose, where we can choose to either give in to our fears or overcome them. It's also a way that we can change our life. And the story I'm going to tell you changed my life. Mr. Toastmaster, fellow Toastmasters, and welcome guests this evening.
Nice, thank you.
Thank you. This is a journey into the realm of paradigms, which are our subconscious beliefs that hold us back from living our dreams, that make us fearful of the things we want to do, but prevent us from doing them. See, the paradigm is the problem in everything we do. It controls our logic, It controls our beliefs, and it controls our fears. And I'm going to show you why that's the case. But I want you to come with me. I want you to come to the edge of your comfort zone. I want you to think that the story I'm going to tell you happened to you. So I want you to imagine that it's you standing here next to me in this group of people on the edge of this mountain, on the edge of this cliff. We're all about to go on an exercise that will take us into our fear. We're standing on this cliff and there are boulders in front of us. We're going to go around the boulder into the unknown, into the unseen, something we do not know is on the other side, but we know is going to terrify us. And we're standing here, having harnesses placed on us, and one by one, we're called to walk around the boulder. There's a bit of nervous tension. Our hands are starting to get a bit sweaty. The heart's beating, the palpitations are going, and maybe the knees are shaking a little bit, trembling. Like there's some guy over there with a pneumatic drill pounding away at the pavement. We can't see it, but we're terrified of the unknown. And then it's our turn, it's your turn, my turn. We walk around the boulder, and there we are on the edge of a very high cliff. Nothing but endless horizon in front of you, and a huge drop 300, 400 feet below. And you're going to jump off the cliff. Attached to a T-bar with a harness clipped to a wire, we're going to take the zip line down to the bottom. But now you can see what's ahead. The little voice starts to go off in your head. The little voice that's saying, this is dangerous. This is bad. I don't want to do this. I'm pretty scared about what's going to happen next. I don't think I can. I mean, you know the little voice, right? That I'm talking. Okay. I got some people who may be not sure. If you're not sure, it's that voice in your head going, what voice? I haven't got a voice. That's the voice he's talking about. That voice. Good. We're there. Great. Because the little voice is really chattering away now. Now, the scientist, you know, what is this? The scientist, I call it the terror barrier. It's that moment of fear where you either step through it or you step back from it. The scientists will call it the amygdala, the reptilian brain, the primitive brain that has us scan for fear, that has us scan for danger. And when it spots it, what it perceives to be danger, says, no, don't go there. We should not do this. This is bad. And most of the time, it's a paradigm. It's a set of beliefs that you picked up in your childhood. Actually, the little voice is your mother going, stay away from the edge. Don't go near the edge. If you go near the edge, you'll die. Well, that's in your head right now. Hey, I'm 35. I'm standing on the edge. And my mother's going, if you go near the edge, you'll die. And I'm stepping back, saying to the instructor, I don't think I should do this. I'm scared. Yes, I know you're scared, she said. But I don't want to do it. Yes, I know you don't want to do it. So can I go back? No. Step up onto the platform. So we're not even on the edge of the cliff here. We're stepping onto a platform that's 3 feet out from the cliff over space. There's nothing there. Now we're really scared. And there's vultures in the sky. Because this was in the United States and America when I did this, and there are actually vultures up there. And I'm thinking, they circle above dead bodies. Usually cows, not humans, but whatever, the voice is going. The instructor has clipped the harness on and says, just take hold of the T-bar, and when you're ready, let go. And at that moment, the little voice goes, my knee hurts. What? My knee hurts? What does that mean to me? And she just kind of looked at me and went, is that the best you've got? And at that moment, I realized something about fear. That fear is an illusion. That this little voice will do anything to stop you from doing something dangerous. But it's not very convincing sometimes. My knee hurts? At that moment, I had power over the fear. Holding the T-bar, lift your knees, and gravity does the rest. And you know what happens when you do it? Nothing. Silence. The little voice shuts up. Because its job is to stop you doing something stupid and dangerous. But the moment you do it, it's over. It shuts up. Its job's done. It failed. So what's the lesson here? When you do the thing you fear, the fear disappears. Don't listen to the voice. And don't let it stop your dreams. There's a quote I'm going to finish with by the American president, Franklin D. Roosevelt, who famously said, "The only thing you have to fear is fear itself." Mr. Toastmaster.
Has Stuart convinced to you how to overcome your fear? Carlos, has Stuart convinced to you? Never fears. Now we have our four speakers. I hope you are taking note of the different speakers, because then I will give you a couple of minutes to write a feedback in the paper and to give them the speaker. Now, I would like to call the evaluator of Stuart, funny lady called Penny. Would you be the evaluator?
I'm doing Ryan, I think.
Ryan, sorry.
Oh, you want me to do Ryan now?
You will be the evaluator, right?
Yeah, okay. Sorry.
No worries. I'm more lost than you.
That's okay. Mr. Toastmaster, fellow Toastmasters, welcome guests. By the way, what I've just said, I'd like everyone to think about it. It's the protocol about acknowledging the person who's up here, who is actually introducing you when you come up here. And I notice in our club we forget to do that. So if people can start to remember, it's a very simple protocol, but it actually acknowledges the person who's introducing you, and it's kind of a manners thing. So that's just the first thing I wanted to mention. It's my pleasure tonight to evaluate Ryan. His speech is number 7 in the Competent Communicator, and this speech is all about research. So something to think about when you do a speech like this is, and people that maybe have to do it at work, I know I have to do it at work and I hate doing it, you have to think about all the statistics, you have to think about stories, you have to think about situations. There are all sorts of different things that you have to think about when you're researching a topic. And so Ryan's speech tonight is exactly about that. I don't know what he's going to talk about, so it'll be really interesting to see. But I want you to listen for those techniques. Has he done his research? And also, has he prepared? One of the things about when you come up here as a speaker is if you don't prepare, it's actually an insult to the people who've taken the time to come here tonight. And I want you to think about that when you do your speeches in the future. You need to be prepared and you need to make as much effort as you can. So let's see what Ryan's going to speak about tonight. I haven't got the name of his speech actually. Can you let me see? Oh, here we go. So Ryan, the makeup of makeup.
Attractive and desirable. Many of us like to feel good about ourselves, and one of the best ways we can do this is through the use of cosmetics and makeup. Fellow Toastmasters and welcome guests, come with me this evening as we explore the makeup of makeup, why we use what we use, and the dark side of all in cosmetics. So in order to begin, we have to go back 6,016 years ago to ancient Egypt. The year is 4000 BC, and the Egyptians believed heavily in their appearance. They believed that their spiritual worth was directly related to their appearance, and Anthony and Lucas reported this in a chapter called Cosmetics, Incense and Perfumes in a booklet that was announced in the Journal of Psychology and Philosophy in May 1930. He reported that the Egyptians used a combination of red copper and lead ore, known as mesdemons at the time, around their eyes to impress the gods. They also used red ochre on their cheeks, which was the first blusher, and they used this to impress the gods. At the end of each evening, it was washed off they used a combination of animal fats and vegetable oils to wash off everything that they put on. At the time, they weren't aware that many of these elements were poisonous and would actually damage the skin very, very badly. And it wasn't just the gods that were impressed, especially when we've got research to prove that the average Egyptian household had 5 children, and we know that Nefertiti had 4 children and Cleopatra had 6. It wasn't just the gods that were impressed. 1,000 years later, China, the Zhao dynasty. The Chinese also believed heavily in rituals and spirituality, and they believed that the best way to express this was using their fingernails. They used gum, gelatin, beeswax, and egg to stain their fingernails. They stained them in gold and silver for royals, and later generations stained them in red and black. The regular civilians were banned from using forbidden colors. They were banned from using anything bright, red, yellow, or green, under the penalty of death. 2,000 years later, 1000 BC, in ancient Rome, one of the most prolific eras in the human generation and known to have some of the best developments. BBC did a study and they announced the results from that study on the 1st and 2nd of July 2006 in Caerleon in Wales, at the National Antiquity Fair. The study that they did proved that many of the ingredients they used were the same as the Egyptians. They used them for the same reasons, for rituals, for beliefs in whoever they believed in up above, and to impress the opposite sex. So they used moisturizer, which was made of rose water, olive oil, and herbs. They also bought gladiator sweat and animal sweat that was sold in Colosseums after events. And the most prolific thing that they created was perfume. And they made this using a blend of flowers, herbs, and natural oils. Though perfume was particularly reserved for the wealthy, and if it wasn't just the wealthy, overuse of it was associated with working women. That kind of working women. They used it to make themselves smell prettier and more attractive to potential clients, and at the same time, it had a counteractive effect because they would apply more on, and at the same time, their workspaces would smell vile, particularly revolting. So in order to make it more attractive, they would use more, which had the same effect of just bringing more of a bad thing to a bad thing. And we know that as their income depends on their appearance, they began to use more as they aged, and they began to look less attractive to their potential clients and customers. So those places really must have smelled disgusting. If they couldn't afford any of that, they used cosmetics, which is similar to cosmetics, but it has a con, because a lot of it isn't real. A lot of it was pushed by black market traders, and at the same time, didn't have real flowers. It didn't have anything that was natural. And it was just a combination of things that they made from blacksmith shops and mixed into rose water and olive oil mixes to make a perfume. Just as it is now, cosmetics is big business. 22nd of May last year, the City of London Police Department reported that they seized 5,500 websites and shut them down. In addition to this, they detained £3.5 million as street worth of cosmetic products, and they raided a warehouse. The warehouse was a production manufacturer. They used this to produce fake cosmetics, and a lot of it on inspection was laced with lead, mercury, and cyanide. Some of the other things that they used, such as mascara and eyeliner, were laced with paint stripper. Not exactly something that you'd like to put around your eyes. And as a result, they actually looked into all the computers that they had there and discovered that many of the products were sold on Facebook and Instagram under the label of production rejects. I think I would reject that option if it was available. But makeup isn't all bad, and throughout history we've proved that it's something that's required. It's something that makes us feel good about ourselves, and a study in the Journal of International Psychology last year proved that. They developed a little test where they had 42 women and they told them to imagine themselves in various situations with or without their makeup. The women that imagined themselves with their makeup reported feeling more confident and more sociable. As well as that, there was another study by the International Journal of Applied Psychology and Sociology, and they discovered that one of the best ways people could feel good about themselves was through cosmetics. And the study they did was to show men and women pictures of other men and women using makeup products, rate them on a scale of 1 to 10, and at the end of it all, they would say who was better. And much of the time, the people that were wearing makeup were perceived as more confident, more trustworthy, more hireable as a potential employee, and a more, generally, just a better person. And the last study that we're going to quote was by the New York Times, where they studied confidence, because yes, makeup does make you more attractive, but it also makes you more confident. And they tested this with women. They got men to spray themselves with scented body sprays and see if women could notice a difference. They did, but they noticed a difference in their body language. It wasn't just the smell, because they noticed differences in men that hadn't even sprayed themselves. So there you have it, the makeup of makeup, why we do what we do, and how long we've been doing it. So next time you're looking for a confidence boost, or you're looking for a way to be more attractive or more perception worthy of other people, simply use cosmetic products. And if you can't afford that, simply imagine it. Mr. Toastmaster.
It's a great story about cosmetic, about perfume, isn't it? I like it. Thank you very much. I feel more curious about perfumes. I would like to write the feedback of the four speakers we have today. For that feedback, we have a paper.
Yes.
For the fourth speaker, can you write the feedback in the topic master, please?
You get to make yourself.
I don't think so. I think that's cheap on the way there.
Okay, yeah. Better idea. Could you write the feedback for the fourth speaker in the general evaluator? Please. Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah, sure.
No, no, thank you. Thank you.
Good. Well, I think.
Yours didn't have a name.
There isn't a fourth speaker, so you could put Brian's name on Puppets Master if you want.
Yeah.
I think at the end we are going to use general evaluator.
Yeah, or general evaluator. So just write Brian's name there, because we've got the speaker 1 and 2.
Well, I think we should continue with the agenda, because we should be on time according to the schedule. So, we are going to start evaluations of the speakers. The first evaluator of the night is not Jennifer, it's Mr. Paul. Can you hear Mr. Paul?
Okay, so David CC1. I think you'll all agree with me at how accomplished this was for a CC1, for an icebreaker speech. I was astonished by the confidence that David showed when he was up there. I felt that we were clearly in the presence of someone who was comfortable up here, who had command of this stage, who had the ability to mould his language to meet our interests. I think this belief in himself was one of the things that was one of the hooks of the speech that kept us interested. His use of gesture made us feel like he was really speaking from the heart. And the fact that he used other hooks, such as "I discovered this the hard way," we knew that we were in for a good story. I think also it's very interesting from this as a CC1 that he did something slightly different to what we normally see with CC1s, and that is he related his own personal experience to a point that was for us, to a learning point for us, being you are the author of your own life. And I think that was a very bold thing to do for a CC1, and he really carried this off well, I felt. I think the eye contact that he maintained with the audience and the gestures I thought were particularly powerful as well. When he was talking about himself, he was pointing at his own heart, and this coupled with the passion and the energy in his voice, I thought were very, very powerful. He used a lot of metaphors, some very advanced techniques. You're writing in pen on the blank pages of your own life. I think this message was repeated several times by David. And this repetition, sometimes we feel that repetition is not so good in our speech, but this simple and powerful message, I think, was emphasized through this repetition, especially at the end when he started embroidering the metaphor in that way. I think this speech had a very strong beginning and end. There were links between the different parts of the speech. He was using things like, "I let you be the judge of this." The running theme is this. He was introducing the different elements of it. We were very prepared by these transitions that he was introducing. And he told us this personal story, which he related to his own experience. And it was interesting that he chose to focus on a particular aspect of his life, rather than to deliver a speech about the whole part of it. And I think it was much more powerful for that. In essence, he drew out something for us that he had learned through facing a battle and overcoming odds in his own life. And I thought that was a very brave and very bold and very powerful thing. And I felt very impressed by this speech. I think going forward, it would be useful for David to have a mentor. I think that there's already a lot of things that he does well, and I think David would particularly benefit from working with someone who is more experienced to pick up little things and to start refining even further those excellent things that he's already doing. I think a round of applause for David, because that was a wonderful speech.
Mr. Paul, thank you very much for this positive feedback. I really like your suggestion, how you say positive points of David with your big, big smile. Thank you. Now, I would like to call the second evaluator of the night. David, how is
really good storyteller. So, although a little bit mistake on the list, you are doing CC5, not CC4. But I'm still looking the CC4 and CC5 at the main time. So, I can see that you did a lot of preparation for this speech. You bring a lot of stuff here. We can see the newspaper and the substitutes, and also you have pen and paper. You didn't find us one. And I think your content is really good. You know, or you already know how to say it. You use the simple words so everyone know what you're saying. And you have a really good sense of humor. That's really good. And for your body language, I think you have a really brilliant gestures to interact with all the audience and use it for 4 to 5 times. And so when you do this, so everyone will know and interact with you. It's really good. So let the audience feel involved. And also you use the newspaper and steel to make songs, and also use your pen make different songs to make a really scared atmosphere, and use your face expression. That's really good. But also your body really speaks. Sometimes when you're thinking, you're like this. And when you are not sure you're saying, your eyes looking up to this side. So your body tells us you're not familiar with this speech. Yeah? So my suggestion is, next time when you deliver speech, maybe come a little earlier so you won't be that rushed, and you can settle down and think about what you are going to say. So be more confident and familiar with your speech. So when you deliver, you won't think about So when you want to tell a scary story, your audience will always keep with you, not sometimes jump out with your thinking and pose, right? And other thing I want to suggest is use the stage. You only like change your feet a little bit like that, and when you want to use some tour, you go to this side of stage, but you didn't come to this side of stage. So next time, move a little bit around, come earlier, talk with your evaluator what you want to achieve from the speech, and see whether there's a mistake on the agenda. Okay? Thank you.
Thank you, Lee, for your positive feedback. How to use the state, how to pose, like a top model. Thank you very much. Now, I would like to call the third evaluator of the night. Mr. Key, your turn.
Toastmaster, Toastmaster, and my most welcome guests. Did any of you notice how sincere Stuart was in his opening? The pause, and eye contact, and direct addressing to all of us together. He meant every last word. And this is a really good example right from the start of how body language really counted in the speech. Every movement that Stuart was doing felt sincere, real. He had a meaning behind everything he did. Throughout the whole speech, his hand gestures were superb. We had our zip lines, we had the cock of the head and the devil on your ear. We had finger pointing from his mother. I think all of it was intentional. One thing perhaps to look out for was there too much of it? Now every single gesture was supporting a speech. Nothing was wasted, everything was smooth. But at the same time, one thing that Stuart didn't make use of was staying still. There were, in fact, some of his best moments in the whole speech were a couple of times he did stay still. I don't know if any of you remember the moments when he said, let's go on a journey together. And that was probably one of the strongest movements of the whole lot. Because something we actually noticed very clearly as people is this area. The one area which is hardest to hide tension, stress, concern, nerves. And so mastering this area of body movement gives a massive link to you and your audience. That moment of calm was really powerful. Other things we did really well
again, not like always at hand, some of his feet as well. Did he ever say to me, this is dangerous? Very small, sort of frantic foot movements, getting us running away with this gesture without having actually much stage by the way in. I think, despite the small stage, it was used really well, and Stuart did use the whole stage. Point to try and look out for, to try and keep things improving for the future, is of course making use of pauses. A few times his default gesture would come back to the lapel clasping. I know I'm guilty myself sometimes. And saying also to watch out when we have small rooms. I don't know if anyone else at the front felt Stuart was looking more towards the back than towards the front of the room. I think when you have a small room, you have to always be aware of where is my audience, where is my looking space? And we see here, from here, if you're looking in a neutral stance with quite low chairs, actually, you don't see the front of the stage very much. So it's just be aware of your surroundings, just let you be aware of the dynamics, aware of the acoustics, aware of the pointy tables. Stuart also asked me to look at the use of humour, and we saw some great use of classical humour devices throughout the entire speech. I think the whole topic of the speech is based around the humour of pity. We have here someone who's terrified, who's fighting in a demon, the "my leg hurts." And it's amazing how much the pathetic, the ridiculous, gets a humorous reaction from us. Especially when it's given so much energy building into it, and that moment of tension just anticlimaxing. But again, classical images, the nagging old lady, no offense, remember. The devil on the shoulder, these are all classical devices, we all relate to it. And all the humor was, simply always had a personal reaction to. All in all, a speech that showed a lot of thought, a lot of practice, very, very carefully chosen gestures throughout. I think the points for improvements are that. Points for improvement on a very, very good speech to start off with. And I hope to see Stuart keep growing on these skills and keep delivering brilliant speeches as always.
Thank you very much, Kate. It's a very, very analytical judgment. It is very difficult to analyze as well because he's a very good speaker, but Juki obtained a very good result. Thank you very much. Now I would like to call the last evaluator of the night.
I'm sorry.
Mr. Lady Penny, your turn.
Thank you, Mr. Toastmaster. And especially Ryan. So did he do his homework?
Oh yes.
Yeah, he did, didn't he? He did. He really showed us that he did his homework. And one of the things I really liked about it is I learned such a lot, and it was really engaging. Because sometimes when people do this speech, after about a minute or so, I kind of zone out and start thinking about I'm going home or whatever. You know, it's just because statistics are they can be boring and dull. How many people sit in meetings and you say, "Oh God, death by bullet point," you know, 500,000. He did not make it boring. He didn't make it boring at all. He used a classic Toastmaster technique, and it's something that I use a lot. In Western culture, we read from left to right. And he used what we call a timeline. Well, he started over here at 1,000 years BC. Is that correct, Ryan? Even I haven't got this to see. Was it BC? I can't remember. I'm terrible. I know it was 1,000 years here with the Egyptians. He told us lots of stories, lots of anecdotes. Then he moved into the centre, so it's a natural progression in years. Came to the centre and talked to about 2,000 years and the Chinese. And then he moved right over here and you talked about, what was the last one?
Romans,
thank you. You see, I'm terrible, yeah, I can't remember. One of my worst things is statistics and information. I can't remember them. So this is a real challenge for me to evaluate him. But then he came back into the centre, and what was really interesting was when after he'd done all his interesting stories, he brought it up to date. Now, I found that quite refreshing. Do people find that interesting? Mm. It was it created a different feel to the speech, didn't it? And I really liked how he brought all the statistics of modern day policing, how much money they found and caught from criminals, and he really made it current. So on that entire journey, he took us on a timeline journey, and then he brought his conclusion into the centre. One of the things I'd like to Ryan to think about is I've noticed he has a kind of habit with his head. I don't know if anyone noticed this. Do you notice that he talks to the people over here a little bit? And I'm doing it, I'm kind of overstating it, but he has a habit. So if you're sat over here, he doesn't really look at you that much. And I don't know if it's just a mannerism of yours, Ryan, but it's something I like to think about and think about in terms of how you're moving. I don't know if it's just your stance, but I was over there and I felt ignored, and I've seen it in other speeches that you've done before. So in terms of something to think about, something for all of us to think about, it's very difficult to look at everybody in the room. It's quite challenging. I'm even trying to do it now, and it's quite difficult to get by all of you. But overall, I loved his speech, and look forward to hearing more speeches in the future. Mr. Toastmaster.
Another very, very analytical evaluation. It is very difficult to evaluate. Ryan and Penny made evaluation really, really nice. Now, I would like to ask the timer for time of play.
Okay, first there was, this is just the evaluations, yeah?
Evaluation and speeches.
Okay, so the, I'll put my speed on. Okay, I'll do the evaluations. So first was me, K with
3 minutes 20.
Then there was E with 2 minutes 15. And then there was K with exactly 3 minutes 30. And then there was Penny with 3 minutes 19.
We
get the times for the speeches.
The speeches, yeah. I left it on the table over there. It's on the table over there.
No.
It's not there, is it?
No.
Oh, is it that one? There we are, yeah, that's what I said. Yep. Okay, so the times for the speeches. We had, first of all, David with CC1, You're the Author of Your Life, on 4 minutes 50. Then we had Carlos, who was 7 minutes and 5. Then we had Stuart on 6 minutes 50. And then we had Ryan on 7 minutes and 55 seconds.
Oh, disqualification.
Going back to the beginning, I asked you a question in order to use your critical thinking. Do you remember? What is the new role tonight? Do you have any idea? Some?
Lord Dance.
Please use your critical thinking of my hands. You have to get
curiosity.
Free dinner.
Enroller. Enroller.
Enroller.
Yeah,
enroller. Close, 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 close. Maybe at the end. So now, let's go to make the break. And after the break, let's go for the table topics. And at the end, maybe I will tell you the answer.
Just a reminder, if anybody wants to participate on table topics, yes, but I'm just doing